Okay. Good morning, everyone. You all seem a little far away right now, I have to say. Can anyone move up? Come up here. There's like this really awesome seat right here. Someone might want to nab it. Couch. So this is our Cinema Café with Morgan Neville, who's a documentary filmmaker and Academy Award winner for his film 20 Feet from Stardom. He has a film at the festival this year called Best of Enemies, and it's his third time at our humble festival. He came the first time with his film Troubadours about folk in the 70s in Los Angeles. Is that accurate?
That's it.
And now he's back with the debate film between Vidal and Buckley here at the festival in competition. And then to my left, Mr. Jonathan Gold, Pulitzer Prize-winning food writer, the first and only food writer to receive a Pulitzer Prize. He has been chronicling food in Los Angeles and New York for the last
30
years. and he is the subject of a wonderful documentary here at the Sundance Film Festival called City of Gold, also in our competition, our US doc competition. Why are these two here together on the stage? Good question. Well, both of these men apparently love Los Angeles. They were born in Los Angeles. They both live in Pasadena, right outside of the main city. They love another LA than most people think of. They're both interested in cultural identity of LA and how we experience that over time. They're both excavators of untold stories and experiences and kind of expanders of the dominant paradigm. And I would say also humanists. Is that accurate?
Yeah, I'm not an anti-humanist.
You're not an anti-humanist? Okay.
Are we secular humanists?
Secular humanists.
Don't tell Lauren Hash.
And why am I up here interviewing them? Well, I really have no right to be honest. But I'm one of the senior programmers of the Sundance Film Festival working in primarily in documentary film. And I too live in Los Angeles, and I too live on the East Side, and I too love Los Angeles. I've only lived there for 16 years, but it has fast become my home. And I take pride in Los Angeles also. I love that everything isn't on the surface and that you have to work to discover it. That if you scratch for just a moment under the surface of Hollywood's media hype, you get something much more subtle, much more complex, and much more meaningful. So with that, I wanted to share why I wanted to talk with you both. And so I wanted to start with this question, really simple question. Why do you love Los Angeles?
Do you think we should hijack it and make it all about Pasadena? Yeah.
Absolutely. Alhambra, maybe.
Alhambra would work. We could talk about Wisteria for a while.
I like that. And San Gabriel Valley, okay, guys.
So how do you mulch your roses?
I guess we should take this seriously or not?
Yeah, sure.
Both and both.
I grew up both in L.A. and then we moved to Santa Barbara, but then I came back to L.A. a lot. I moved to the East Coast to go to college, and I found myself in that situation of being one of those L.A. who, you know, you're from L.A. and thought you were from, you know, a desert somewhere, certainly a cultural desert. And I became a total, at the time, an L.A. apologist. I don't call myself an L.A. apologist anymore. I'm just
what do you call yourself?
A booster. I'm a full-on booster. And, you know, I decided, you know, so I was always kind of saying, no, you don't understand. There's all this incredible stuff there. And I worked as a journalist for a number of years in New York and then San Francisco, and I came up with the idea for my first documentary, which was going to be my treatise on L.A. called Shotgun Freeway, Drives Through Lost L.A. And it was a scarily ambitious idea to do kind of a historiography of L.A., like what does history mean in L.A.? And, you know, I ended up profiling a dozen Angelenos, Joan Didion, James O'Reilly, Buck Henry, Burt Corona, Latino activist, Betty Collette, a jazz musician, different people looking at L.A. through their eyes. And the idea that L.A. isn't a city like any other city, and it doesn't have a history like any other city. You know, most cities have a history that's centered around a power structure and a city hall, and it's geographically centered. And what we explored is somebody growing up in South Central or somebody growing up in Van Nuys has a completely different idea of what the city is and what the history is that is totally unrelated. And that, you know, most cities, again, have this, I think of it as like a vertical history. Yeah. LA has a horizontal history, you know, so it doesn't go back hundreds of years, but it's very broad and it still has the same amount of depth to it. It's just thinner and much, much wider.
I mean, it's odd. Sometimes when you run across actual history in Los Angeles, it seems strange and abstract, and you're almost surprised that it's there, like the crossings of the Rio Hondo in the sort of Whittier area, right? I mean, there were actual battles fought for that. You know, that it was, you know, the sort of strategic pass between the rest of California and Los Angeles for a really long time. And, you know, a lot of people on, you know, both the Mexican side and the American side died there. But you drive across it now and it's like a bridge, and when you talk to people about its historic nature, people are freaked out that the Campo de Cahuenga in the valley, which is where the Treaty of the Battle of Cahuenga was signed, essentially, you know, Mexico ceding California to the United States, it's like it's near and completely subsumed by a giant parking lot. and I don't think, whereas when you're in New York and you talk to people, you do have some idea where the Battle of Brooklyn was fought, and you do have some idea about you know, George Washington being holed up at the Francis Tavern. You have some idea of the history there. In Los Angeles, nobody knows about it. When you tell them about it, they're utterly puzzled.
Why do you think that is? Is anything sacred in Los Angeles?
Sacred? No. You know, LA's never been a city that's looked back a whole lot. I remember when I started that first documentary, and I tell people I was doing a documentary on LA history, and, you know, it was like the greatest oxymoron of all time. You know, people would laugh. It was a punchline. And it was interesting. So my first job, when I was making that documentary, I got a day job producing Huell Hauser's TV show. Do people here know Huell Hauser?
Yeah. Tell them who it is.
He had a show on KCT, local PBS, that was on for 25 years, where he would go around and he had this thick Tennessee accent. And he'd say, "Golly, are you telling me this is the original, you know, clock that was, you know, et cetera, et cetera?" And actually, I loved doing that show. I always, because Shotgun Freeway is like this dystopian view of LA, and Huell was pure utopian view. So I had the, like, and literally, I was working by day with Huell doing this version, and I'd start editing at 6 p.m. till 3 a.m., and I'd do my version of LA, and I had this incredible kind of back and forth, but they totally informed one another.
Did he ever let you shoot anything in his supervillain lair?
No.
I've only seen pictures of that place, but...
Oh, up in the Ravenswood?
No.
Oh, like, no, out in the desert.
Out in the desert, yeah. He had this place, like, you know...
On the mountain.
On the mountain.
Yeah, yeah.
That was, like, a flying saucer had landed there, and you can totally see, like, hundreds of Bond villains come pouring out.
It was like a military... It was crazy. He bought it after I'd stopped working for him, but I'd seen pictures of it. Yeah, it was this giant mound in the middle of a flat desert with a little house perched on top. And
I want to push this question of history a little more. I'm really glad you talked about it, because I think time and LA and history is a really kind of weird and interesting confluence. Because, Morgan, your work, if I really think about it, is all looking back. I mean, 20 Feet from Stardom, you know, jettisons us up to the future, but I think all of your music films are looking at the past, and your current film is looking at, you know, a moment in history, okay, recent history. But, and Jonathan, your work, in a way, at least right now, is about the present. It's about introducing people to what's happening in the present. Do you think about history when you write about present tense, when you write about restaurants and cooking and food and immigration and culture right now in LA?
Well, any time you have food, you can't just look at what's on your plate in isolation, which I think is a problem with a lot of people in my particular micro profession. Everything comes from a place. Everything is there for a reason. There's all kinds of, you know, cultural reasons, there's historical reasons, there's geographical reasons that what you're getting out of play at any specific time is there. And it's impossible to write about it unless you know the history of it, to know that you can instinctively know if you go to farmers markets that, you know, there's this one stand that consistently has strawberries that cost three times as much and are three times as good as everybody else's strawberries. But in some way, if you're just buying the strawberries, you know that they're delicious, it's one thing, but like knowing about the history of, say, Japanese farmers in California and how their land was all taken away during World War II, knowing about the history of like agriculture and fruit growing on the Oxnard Plain where they're from, knowing about the idea of agricultural cooperatives and how that's fit into the city, and knowing about the history of crossbreeding of fruit.
And Monsanto.
I guess Monsanto, but not even most.
It's not really a history.
Yeah.
But it
is. And people in 30 years are going to be able to look on the Monsanto moment, and I hope that it's not because some of the, you know, engineered genes have like escaped and had really strange and untoward and disastrous effects that some people are afraid of.
But are you saying that then knowing something about the richness of what comes of the context of that strawberry, does it make the strawberry taste better?
I think it makes the strawberry taste better because you know what it is. I mean, if you're eating a breed like a Chandler that was grown for size and for sweetness and for a particular expression of that of strawberry fragrance over period, then I think it makes it a richer experience than eating the same strawberry and just knowing that it tastes better than a supermarket strawberry, which in fact was grown for its ability to be shipped and to stay in a supermarket for 2 weeks and was harvested super green and was ripened by exposing it to ethylene gas. So even though it looks like a beautiful strawberry, it tastes like cotton.
I mean, I think for both of you, one of the other reasons why I think we were so excited to have you both here together is the way that you work, actually, that you both work in a way through portals that lead us to something to something else. So in Morgan's case, music, you know, looking at sort of music history and musical and people making music and what it's a portal to something much grander, much greater about our society and about human beings and their experiences. And food for Jonathan, of course, is absolutely a magical portal into a rich culture that we live in Los Angeles. Do you want to talk a little bit about those portals and how they work for you?
I mean, it's one reason I love making music films is not only am I a music geek through and through, and it's a chance for me to investigate these worlds of music, but music is a perfect Trojan horse for telling a different story. I mean, every great music documentary is about something other than music, and it allows you to bring, you know, what music brings with it is, you know, history and emotion, and, you know, it's an incredible tool to be able to use to tell a story, but you still have to tell a story, and I love using music as a way into talking about, you know, everything from civil rights or agriculture or gender, anything. You know, music just gives you a framework to tell that story that brings in an audience too and makes it familiar. And then once they get there, you can tell them a different story.
There was this astonishing moment in 20 Feet from Stardom where you talked to a couple of people that sang background vocals on Sweet Home Alabama. And, you know, Sweet Home Alabama is just, you know, it's a song you rock out to. It's a song that you hear. It sort of has some regional thing, but you never think about it that much. And the way that you looked at it, I saw that song in a completely different way than I had ever seen it before. You're taking something super familiar and you're recontextualizing it, looking at it through the eyes of different musicians, and it becomes a completely different thing.
I mean, that's fun for me as a filmmaker, and I learn that stuff as I'm making the film. Taking the familiar, because the song is the familiar, and then making you hear it anew. I mean, I love being able to do that with music docs, and it's something Jonathan does so, so well with his writing. I'm a huge fan. So.
And you know, sorry, go.
No.
It just occurred to me, I always think of music and eating as sensualities that avoid the brain. Like, the brain is not necessary. They go straight in. They don't have to be mediated through thinking. So you both have, would you agree? No?
Well, I know in what I do, and I was a music writer for a really long time before I sort of decided, music and food, before I started to specialize in food, that when you're writing about them, it's very close, because when you're writing about the way that a guitar solo sounds, it's abstract. And, you know, I'm trained in musicology and composition, so I can tell you exactly what's going on and why, say, a guitar riff sounds the way it does and why it sounds different from other ones and how it specifically powers a song in a way. It used to be fun to actually interview bands and talk to them about that stuff. And they would
be like, what?
I remember telling, you know, talking to the singer from Metallica about how, you know, there was one phrase on Master of Puppets that really reminded me of a passage from Stravinsky's Symphony of Psalms. And he, like, looked at me and said, who's Stravinsky? But again, if you're looking at music and you're looking at food, you need the context. And I think as a documentary maker, and as I think as a writer, our jobs are to provide the context in which things are seen, so you understand something in a way that you might not have understood it before. There are worlds to be explored in a single taco.
Absolutely, absolutely. Yes. Go ahead.
I mean, one other thing, I'd be interested to hear what Jonathan has to say, but I mean, something we both have worked in and around too is art in Los Angeles.
Yeah.
And I, you know, to me, you know, I made a film called The Cool School
about
the Ferris Gallery and kind of the birth of the modern art scene in LA and how LA seeded an art scene, you know, with people like Walter Hopps and Irving Blum and everybody back in the late 50s.
Ed Ruscha and Baldessari
exactly.
And all those people. Yeah.
And I'm curious what your kind of entree was into the art world in LA.
I was a composer, but I was at UCLA and the music department was very conservative. And I was very interested in sort of like performative music that, you know, guys like Stockhausen were doing in Germany. And a lot, and Xenakis in Greece, and the issues that I was trying to address in the music that I was writing seemed actually to be closer to performance art at the time. So I started, you know, hanging out at the north part of the campus, and I spent, you know, years sort of sitting at the feet of Chris Burden, the performance artist who, of course, is a famous installation artist now. And I suppose it was that way. I mean, Chris had such an interesting view of art. His relationship to it was different. He was part of the sort of avant-garde of that post-war whole school, which was sort of anti the pop commercialism and trying to make things that couldn't be sold, to have experiences that could be held in your mind but couldn't be held in your hand.
I mean, one of the things we explored in The Cool School, and I think one of the reasons LA came up with its own artistic voice, is that it wasn't burdened by the history of art. You know, and LA is one of those cities that isn't burdened by history. I mean, it creates a certain freedom within that.
Yeah, let's talk more about that freedom, that sense of, you mentioned it also at the beginning, that infinite, the infiniteness, the broadness of the space, of the physical space, that Is it and yes, in the Cool School, many of your characters talk about how there just wasn't an art history in LA before we got here, so we just did whatever we wanted. What is that freedom? Is there freedom in Los Angeles for people to do what they want to do?
Oh, though I must say, actually, there was an art history, and there was a history of like plein air painting in specifically in Pasadena. Yeah, that's just
exactly.
Stunning. The
people
like School.
Millard Sheets and all kinds of other people and a folk art craft tradition, and you know, Beatrice Woods and all these people.
Yeah. But it is the idea that the people on the East Coast have always had, that you could move to Los Angeles and start fresh, that you weren't burdened by what your family did in, you know, Brooklyn or Boston. I went to a high school where probably two-thirds of the kids had parents who had moved from, like, actually specific neighborhoods in Brooklyn to go to Los Angeles and to work in the entertainment industry. It was sort of an odd microcosm. And the school reunions from Erasmus High School are still held in Beverly Hills, I think, instead of in Brooklyn, because nobody lives in Brooklyn anymore.
And Brooklyn Avenue in Boyle Heights, right?
Exactly.
Now Cesar Chavez.
But Los Angeles has continued to be sort of a tabula rasa for so many generations of people that have moved there. Los Angeles always seems like probably more to the outside people than to people who live there, but it seems like a place that one goes to as much as a place where somebody is from. And you're able to build as close of a microcosm of, say, you know, upper middle class Persian cafe society in, you know, along Westwood Boulevard as has ever existed in Tehran. In fact, it obviously doesn't exist in Tehran anymore. That you're able to, you know, build gigantic Chinese communities that go on for 20 miles and, unlike any place in China or Taiwan, actually have people that are from all parts of China, and they all want to assert their cultural individuality equally strongly, and there's none of the sort of hierarchy that would have existed in China or would have existed in Hong Kong. And when you have all parts of culture pushing equally hard and coming from an equally rich background, it becomes this mosaic. This is stunning. I mean, nothing like it exists in the world. The old idea of the melting pot in Los Angeles doesn't exist. I mean, because there's 1,000 ways to be American there. And the idea that everybody's coming through, say, you know, Ellis Island, they're all getting the same examinations and talked to by the same people and moving into the same neighborhoods and gradually becoming Americans in the way that, say, Saul Bellow describes so well, doesn't happen there. I mean, the idea of, like, second-generation Korean-American culture is as vivid and as strong as any culture in L.A., and it's like both the idea of living in Los Angeles and the idea of being Korean, and they can exist at the same time.
I mean, I think of it a little ways instead of, you know, this melting pot, it's much more this idea of cosmopolitanism, you know, and you think about what they call the edge effect in science, where you have two different climate zones rubbing up against one another, and there are more different forms of life in they call it the edge effect, in those areas where different zones rub up against one another than anywhere else in nature. And I think of LA being that way. It's not that these communities lose their individuality, but you get interesting combinations. That's something Jonathan's written a lot about, and something I see and eat all the time.
A lot of it is the sort of, it's the thing that the cultures running into each other, like the Thai restaurant in Hollywood, whose customers are about 95% Salvadoran. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're basically going to Thai food because they want a better seafood soup, but their taste and what they're expecting is completely different from what a Thai person is expecting, and it's different from what, you know, a white guy from the West Side is expecting.
So, okay, as white guys, mm-hmm. You make movies and you write about cultures outside the one you were raised in. Can we talk about that? What's that like? How do you enter those cultures? And how does research come into that? And how do you prepare yourself? And how do you approach it? What's that process for both of you?
I mean, Jonathan's much more on the front lines of that than I am, you know, because what I do is, you know, I'm digging deep into a certain area, you know, and I kind of think of making a documentary like getting a master's degree. You know, it takes about as long, you learn about as much, you know, and that's kind of my perfect attention span. Like, I'm not a PhD person, and I'm not like a magazine journalist that only wants to spend a few months. Like, I like spending like 2 years delving into something.
But like African-American women backup singers, how do you enter that world? What's that like for you, Morgan?
I mean, the quick thing on that film was we came up with this idea for the movie, but there was no way to research it. There were no books, nothing. There was no, on Google, there was nothing about backup singers. And what you realized is there are about 200 backup singers. It's a tiny community. They all know everybody else. And the only thing to do is to sit down and talk to them. And so I spent 3 months and I did 50 oral histories. I ended up doing many more, but that was the initial 50, just to figure out what the whole world was about. And then you just dive into it and go as deep as you can. And you can only just be yourself and they understand what you're doing and you build trust and all the stuff you do as a documentarian. So you build these, it's about relationship building.
You talked about humility, Jonathan, at your Q&A a couple of days ago. I'm sure there's much more to it, but that's what made me want to ask this question of both of you.
No, it's... If you're going and you're writing about culture and you walk in there assuming that you know everything, you're not going to get much. Or if you go in there with an expert guide, you're going to know exactly what the guy tells you, but you're not going to know anything beyond that because there are going to be those walls there. And I don't know. I mean, in a way, it sounds colonialist and probably coming from a position of privilege, but there's the idea of culture surfing is just incredibly fascinating to me. The idea that, you know, you can go into a place and you could be the only person not of that particular culture, and you eat the food. And
culture surfing is what I said, culture surfing.
And you eat the food and you smell the smells, and maybe you overhear some conversations, and maybe you talk to some people. And, you know, one time isn't going to do it, and two times isn't going to do it. And sometimes you end up going back to a place and immersing yourself in it, like, you know, 8 or 9 or 10 times. And you start to learn to, I use food as a prism because I find food useful. And it's what I'm paid to write about. But you start to learn to appreciate what's on the plate, not in your sort of, you know, monolithic focused idea of what something should be, but you learn to be able to take it in context, to be able to look at a Taiwanese dish in the way that it was meant to be looked at, to appreciate it in the way that it's meant to be appreciated. And in some ways, whether it's great or it's not great, that matters a lot when you're reviewing a restaurant to say if something's good or not, but to actually be able to describe what it is and to be able to describe the process of approaching it, I think, is just as important and probably more interesting.
I'm wondering, Jonathan, how much of a sense of kind of mission you have about this or a sense of impact your writing's going to have on trying to open people's minds or stomachs, or do you think about that when you write?
I don't think I think about it. And probably when I'm doing one review, it may have an impact one way or another, but it's sort of the accretion of them, right? I mean, it's like, you know, when you have a drop of water, you know, dripping from the roof of a cave, it's just a drop, but you have you know, a million drops and suddenly there's a stalactite. And the idea of having like a body of work, of having reviewed 1,000 restaurants and having, you know, I hate to use the word, but like taught people how to appreciate the cuisine. I think that would be the final product rather than any individual review. I mean, the way that one scene in a movie, you know, scene in the abstract could be beautiful or could not, and you could say this works, this doesn't work, and you could talk about the lighting, and it's the sort of stuff as a filmmaker you do all the time, but it's the whole thing that really makes the difference, right? Mm-hmm.
Can I pose that to you, Morgan? Do you have a mission?
I don't. Okay. I don't. You know, a lot of times, and I get these questions, and I apply for grants for films, and you always get these questions about, you know, how you want to change the world with your film.
Right.
I never, ever, ever think about that. I try and think about what's the film I want to see. You know, that's it.
Yeah, yeah. There's a lot of pressure in our business, Jonathan, about sort of impact, the impact of the work, and there's a big debate about that.
Yeah, and I think about a film like Grey Gardens. Like, what's the social impact of a film like that? You know, would anybody give that film a grant?
Yeah. You know,
no.
but I must say that, I mean, I'm talking about the role of a critic in general, that it is very rare that you see an important art scene spring up, or an important music scene spring up, or an important food city spring up without having a critic in the midst of it who's able to make sense of it all and put it out in a way that makes it comprehensible.
I'm so glad. Let's talk about the role of a critic from both points of view.
I just remember in The Cool School, Walter Hopps came up with a plan to make LA have an art scene. And he said, and I hope I can remember all these, there are five things you need for an art scene. You need artists, you need people to buy that art, you need a museum to institutionalize that art, you need critics to spread the gospel of that art, and what was the fifth thing? I'm not gonna think of it.
Money?
Well, the money or the buyers, you know. Or maybe it's some educations, schools, you know, art schools. So if you have those five things, you can build an art scene. But the critics are they're the St. Paul's of the whatever the scene is, you know.
Wow, that's an interesting way of putting it.
Yeah.
but it's true. If there's no St. Paul, Christianity becomes, you know, either sort of a minor, you know, beautiful cult, or it becomes something completely different, mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Critics have that sort of 10,000 foot view, like they're watching. They're watching, you have distance, so you can connect dots for us that we don't have in our daily lives. We don't have that kind of...
Perspective.
Yeah.
And sometimes, especially when you're dealing with a sort of not obviously intellectual medium, that you can provide sort of the backbone of a worldview that artists or chefs, in my case, can like hang their art on, hang their pieces on, that almost the best thing you can do as a critic is to provide a through line. Mm-hmm. And actually, often in movie criticism, that's bad because there are so many movies come out and so many critics have through lines that may not have anything to do with the movie that you're making.
You're hinting at something I really wanted to talk to you both about, which is sort of a verboten topic in the film community, but that's, I want to talk about intellectualism. So Morgan, you just made a film about two intellectuals who, and I'm borrowing from a colleague who pointed out that it's a film in Best of Enemies about two intellectuals presiding over the end of intellectualism in America, in a way. And I wondered for both of you, what role is intellectualism a dirty word in your work? Does it get in the way? Is it something do you consider yourselves intellectuals? Let's talk about this.
I mean,
beleaguered word.
It's interesting because America is such an anti-intellectual society these days, and even nobody wants to call themselves an intellectual. And
no one wants to call themselves a feminist. It's like a dirty word.
Yeah, it is like a dirty word, and everybody.
I am a feminist.
Thank you.
Me too.
Sorry, I'd get it tattooed if I believed in such things.
But there's this, you know, everybody kind of wants to be dumb, you know, and when you see our politicians, you know, Obama bowling or George Bush pretending he didn't go to Yale, you know, what's this all about? Like, and to me, the big question I wanted to ask with this film, which is a question I have all the time about our society, is where are the adults? You know, what happened to the grown-ups that are supposed to be worrying about these things long-term? And as we turn away from people, not saying that Gore Vidal and Wayne Buckley were the embodiment of that, but they represented at least a chance to have people with real erudition and thought help inform our decisions. You know, now we have a punditocracy of hundreds of people that go on TV, and we have no idea what credentials they have or who they are. And
they're just good at you know, yeah. hurling epithets.
Yeah, I don't know why I just thought of this, but my father fell completely in love with, you know, Jimmy Carter in the 76 campaign when somebody asked him what his favorite music was, and he said, you know, late Shostakovich string quartets. And then, of course, you know, that turned into the Allman Brothers in about 2 weeks when he realized who the electorate actually was. But
and then you have Clinton playing jazz.
Ah, that's what they call it. But there are two things. One, because there is this in a way, there's an anti-intellectual streak in America, and there always has been. I mean, Mark Twain made a living out of making fun of those people while being probably the most rigorous, you know, technical formal writer of the period. And there's that contradiction, is that there have to be the underpinnings in the work. You have to absorb the grammar of what you're expressing. And the way to do it and the sort of philosophy behind it. And then you have to sort of just forget about it and to do the work. And, you know, have there been times when I've based, you know, a longer piece or a column on some concept I read in, say, you know, Walter Benjamin's Arcades Project? Yeah, sure, I mean, that's my, like, favorite book ever. Will I ever mention Walter Benjamin in the LA Times? Oh, no.
Why? Do your editors not want you to, or would you like to?
Oh, my editors will let me do whatever I want to do. But there's just the sense that if you are putting, since I deal with, I know it sounds weird because it's food, but I deal with sometimes difficult things to begin with, right? I mean, it's, you know, it's about the food, but it's also about the process of being an American. It's also about being Los Angeles. It's also about, like, the relationship of everything.
Just a small thing, the relationship of everything.
I mean, you know, the relationship of people to one another. And the idea is that it has become extraordinarily hard to write about sort of race and ethnicity in America. And I write about it every week. And I've got to find a way of doing that without stereotyping on one hand or being sort of overly worshipful on the other. And I use the second person a lot in my reviews because it's a way of making people feel as if they're part of what they're doing. I mean, I guess there's a thing in this film.
It's like you're inviting them.
Yeah.
Inviting them in.
So I don't want to alienate people. I mean, it's like, even if you're a writer, even if you're a journalist, you're also an entertainer. And the objective is to get people to actually finish your column, to get to the end of what you're writing. And then almost whatever they glean from it is gravy, right?
Right.
But it's possible to express difficult concepts in appealing ways. And, you know, obviously his work is doing that.
So I have one more question for Jonathan.
Go ahead. I've got a ton more too.
This is a very selfish question.
Go for it.
What dish should I get in Pasadena? What dish should I run out and get?
One dish, huh?
Just a restaurant.
Oh, but it actually has a really good, thriving Mexican-American restaurant community, which you wouldn't think. There's a place called Tony's on Orange Grove in Lake that's almost like the perfect Mexican-American neighborhood restaurant. They have just killer chili verde and really good pozole. And, you know, there's no alcohol, but they make, you know, like fruit shakes to order. And you'd like it.
I'm on my way.
Now, while we're on the topic, I have so many. Okay, I'm going to hurry up and get to some other juicy questions. Like, okay, so there's this opposition in LA between, let's go back to LA, between West Side, East Side, and what that's become, you know, is everyone seems kind of encrusted in the identities of West Side and East Side, but now downtown is kind of coming, you know, having a renaissance, and it feels very alive down there more and more. Meanwhile, you two are living in Pasadena. Why are you living in Pasadena, and what do you think's going on in terms of West Side, East Side?
I mean, one thing, I went to kindergarten in Pasadena on the block that I live on, so I actually live on the block I went to kindergarten on, which is interesting, you know, so there is history here and coming full circle. And, you know, when I first moved back to LA, I tried Venice, and I just wasn't a West Side person. And then I moved.
What does that mean?
Well, geography is destiny, as Timothy Leary said about Los Angeles. That, you know, particularly as the city gets more choked with traffic, you have to choose your own psychogeographic city and geographic city of what your LA is going to be, and, you know, the stores you're going to go to, the restaurants you're going to go to, the people you're going to see. And it's just about finding your community within the city. It's a reason that I think, you know, I say that LA is a great place to live, but you wouldn't want to visit there.
Yeah, totally.
You know, it's that idea that it's about figuring it out. It's why people who generally don't like LA if they're not from there, because they come and they spend all their time visiting friends on opposite ends of the city on the same day. And, you know, it's the easiest way to hate the city is, you know, but it's about decoding it and figuring out what that city is you want to live in, which has got to be, just for a manageability perspective, a much smaller city. And for me, that's, you know, I work in Echo Park, and I live in Pasadena, and that's kind of my corner.
Yeah. And Pasadena, there are so many interesting sort of contradictory paradigms there, right? It's like it's the traditional city in Southern California of sort of, you know, moneyed leisure. It's but it's also majority-minority city that, you know, when I lived in L.A. proper, parties I go to in L.A. proper, you sometimes are all dominated by food people or all dominated by film people. And in Pasadena, the parties tend, you know, there'll be a writer, there'll be a film person, there'll be a fireman, there'll be a couple scientists from JPL.
Jet Propulsion Laboratory.
When I moved onto my block, every other neighbor on it either taught at either Caltech or the Fuller Seminary, so it was, you know, rocket scientists and seminarians.
Cosmic.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to ask one more question, then we're going to go to y'all out there. I'm trying to, which one do I want to ask? Here's a question. So LA, okay, we know, we love it, you love it for very various reasons. It's racked with problems, choking traffic, bad public school system. What will it be like in 10 years? And if you could wish anything for it, what's your fantasy of the future of LA?
Well, I think everybody has the same fantasy, right? I mean, it's like a lot like the city that was in that Spike Jonze movie, Her.
People walking on the streets.
People walking on the streets, like a really good transit system with fabulous views. That everybody seems prosperous. I can only do for Los Angeles what I do for Los Angeles. And if I was going to have to do like an overarching reason for doing what I do, I want people to live in the entire city and not just in their little corner of it. I want people not to be afraid of their neighbors. I want people to be able to experience everything that there is to be experienced. And I think if that happens, we'll all be a lot happier.
I mean, I love that idea, and, you know, it's part of what You know, I love exploring LA too, even though you have your own city. You know, and I remember once having lunch with somebody who grew up in Santa Monica, and I dragged him downtown for something, and he looked at City Hall and said, "What's that building?" And
you've never seen Dragnet?
I know, exactly. Or Superman, the original Superman. So, I mean, there's that kind of, that's the flip side of that kind of myopic vision of LA, which maybe it's my bias, but I tend to think people who live west of the 405 are more guilty of than people live east of the 405. Are there hisses in the audience? Just because, you know, crossing the 405 these days is pretty much a day-long event, you know. But, and I think in a lot of ways, LA is trying to do the right thing. I mean, seeing what's happened in the past years culturally is amazing and heartening. You know, John Baldessari told me that, you know, he taught forever at CalArts. And he said for 20 years, he would tell his students upon graduation, move to New York. And about 10 years ago, started saying, stay here. You know, that there was finally, LA was just trying to make it happen, and it just was never happening, and I think it's finally happening now, for real.
Yeah, I think in a lot of the world, the LA art scene is the one that people are looking to more than New York.
Yeah, which is great. And, you know, we're, transportation, they're trying to make it better. You know, I feel like they're trying, but as most cities do, they do it, you know, slowly, strangely, and bureaucratically.
Great. Okay, let's incorporate all of you wonderful people in the purple, please. Hold for the mic.
Thanks. I don't know if this is on. I have a question about food. I don't know the right term for it, but there's so much cross-pollination and hybridization happening, especially in terms of, you know, communities from different parts of the world coming in and adapting to the American palate and so on. I just wanted to know your point of view on this. Do you like it, or are you more of the school of thought of, you know, what some would call bastardization of authentic cuisines? And what would you say is the best and worst of this kind of movement?
Well, I don't think there's anything. I think the idea of authenticity in cuisine doesn't exist. But in one sense, like, authenticity is the least important thing, but it's also the most important thing. So it's hard to hold those two ideas in mind at the same time, but you kind of have to. That if you're looking at, say, Italian food, for example, tomatoes were considered impossibly vulgar in, like, basically north of Tuscany in Italy until 30 years ago. That you know, Thai people cook for thousands of years without chili peppers. That the Irish got potatoes, you know, what, the 1700s, and that wherever you are, cuisine is constantly changing. And if you look at history, there'll be a dish that's like invented in Turkey, and it'll work its way through the Levant, and you'll find versions of it, you know, thousands and thousands and thousands of miles away in Singapore, where it's come through Malaysia. The cuisine is never a static thing. That being said, I think the things I like about Los Angeles are, A, the idea that it is possible to get, like, food from, you know, parts of China and Korea and Mexico and El Salvador replicated on almost a village level, which is hard to find anywhere else in the world. But on the other hand, some of the food that I find absolutely the most exciting at the moment is food by, you know, children of immigrants who have, you know, grown up, gone to cooking school, gone to work at for maybe famous chefs in France or Italy or New York, and come back and use their European technique in order to interpret the flavors that they grew up on. And some of those restaurants are just utterly thrilling.
Yes, sir. There's a mic.
Hi, I'd like to hear from both of you how you think I'd like to hear from both of you how you choose your subject matter. And I'm guessing you're both curious characters and enjoy that initial discovery process. But I'd like to hear, especially from Morgan, like what's the most amount of time you spent looking at possible subject matter and then deciding not to make the film moving on?
I mean, we were just talking about that. I mean, when people ask me about becoming a documentary filmmaker, what's the most important trait? I say curiosity, hands down. You know, and if you love to learn, it's the best job there is. I mean, it's why I do it, because I get to learn all the time. And I'm also lucky enough to think about things I'm interested in and say, okay, I'm going to go get my documentary master's degree in that subject. You know, I get to dive deep into something. I mean, right now, I'm shooting a documentary with Yo-Yo Ma about his Silk Road project, and it's a world, you know, so I've come to know these musicians from Iran and China and Syria and Jordan, and it's just a world I didn't know that much about, and I'm learning so much, and it's exciting for me, and it's bringing up all these same issues of tradition and authenticity, you know, the idea of the Silk Road, you know, these instruments that seem like pure embodiments of cultural tradition are in fact, you know, borrowed from Spain or China or India or Japan. And, but one of my lost projects was, you know, I spent several years working on a Raymond Chandler documentary, another great LA subject, somebody who I loved, and I interviewed everybody who was alive who knew him. But, I mean, beyond the fact that it's not that easy to get a documentary like that funded, it's very difficult to take a character like that and make it cinematic, and I couldn't figure out how to make it. Kept feeling more like a book than a movie, but there have been so many Chandler books that I felt like that wasn't my role with that, so that was kind of a long dead end, a very interesting educational one, but it was a dead end.
You want to talk about how you come to your material?
I drive around a lot.
In a green truck, I might add.
But I've been working on a book that'll be out in a couple of years on Pico Boulevard. I mean seen through the food, but also seen through the geographical place in the city, and looking at Pico as sort of LA's back porch, and doing a lot of research into the life of Pio Pico, who I find like utterly fascinating.
Absolutely. I actually stole something from your Pico project that I taught a class at SciArc on filmmaking. Wow. And we gave every student a chunk of Pico Boulevard and had them each make a short documentary. And then we strung them all together and had a little documentary project.
Is that available online?
It's not, actually. It should be. And I said you could do anything you want within that 1 mile. It could be a profile of a person that runs a store, it could be about the neighborhood, it could be about anything within that stretch of street.
That's interesting. There was a class that I took in geography at UCLA that in a way informed a lot of what I was doing, where you were supposed to make a map of one side of one block. Mm-hmm. And I drew a block in Midtown. It had Shibucho, which was mm-hmm. the best sushi bar in town at the time, that was had no sign, but it was identified by two cones of salt, and there was on each side of the door, very, very, very zen. You know, there was a Korean bar, there was a 7-Eleven owned by Pakistanis, there was a laundromat where people from different non-Spanish speaking people from Central America were each, you know, like hoarding the dryers for their own specific national group. And a German restaurant, and it's like fascinating trying to like piece it all together as a whole. It's not that different from what I do now.
Exactly. Yes.
Now this is a question from Morgan. Really inspired by your body of work. A question: when you're researching and developing a project, what is your process of, you know, going to the core, finding the heart of the story, especially when it's about a moment, a group of people, something that's so vast?
I mean, it's journalism. You know, I know I've talked to Caroline about this, that, you know, I was trained as a journalist, And, you know, so often when people talk about filmmaking and documentary filmmaking, they talk about it as being an artist, you know, which I get uncomfortable with terms like that. You know, I feel like I'm a journalist at heart, and that it's that, those skills. You know, I've hired a lot of kids out of LA film schools to work for me, and I feel like they take kind of a film school approach to filmmaking, which is, you know, what's your vision? What do you want to say? And I feel like documentary filmmaking is so much more about listening. What do you want to hear? You know, don't ask questions you know the answer to, ever. So I feel like it's that process that people need to stop thinking like filmmakers and think more like journalists.
Though they do tell you in journalism school that you're never supposed to ask a question that you don't know the answer to.
I thought you were going to say that they do tell journalists in journalism school to think more like filmmakers. Okay, we actually only have time for one more. Go ahead, you. I try to do male, girl, boy.
So I'm just curious, when you're learning about all of these small, if LA has this strong presence of so many different cultures, and that's why you guys have so much pride in the city, then what, all the people that represent those cultures, they're just, they're individuals representing one identity. And then we go in and experience all of it, and that's what we see LA as. So I guess it's like the relationship between individual identity and collective identity, and if you guys have any reflections on that.
Well, I mean, I may be going in there and experiencing the Oaxacan community and you know, looking at basketball games at the gym and having street food and going to restaurants and learning about the different kinds of mole. But at the same time, the Oaxacan people are doing the same thing with the Korean community. And everybody's sort of, you know, what was that Gang of Four song, At Home He's a Tourist?
Yeah, exactly. I'd love to end on Gang of Four, but it's that sense of psychogeography that, you know, everybody has their own vision of what the city is, and I think that's awesome. So.
Beautiful. Thank you so much to these illustrious and wonderful artists to my left. Thank you to you.